Our goal for today is to talk about how bent or curved our curve is that we have. Now, it's important to understand, we're not talking about the parameterization, so we don't care about how fast we travel. So we could zip along, or we could go very slowly. But the result is the same curve, the same set of points. And so what we want to do is say, well, do we have some way to measure something which is moving rapidly, changing directions, versus something which hardly changes direction at all? We do. It's called curvature. And let's take a look. So what do we want? Well, again, to emphasize, we're really looking at the curve itself, not the way that we travel along the curve. And so we sort of have this idea of saying, well, look, a curvature is a measurement of how much we're twisting, how much we're bending. And so we would say something with low curvature isn't really moving much else. It barely has any bend to it. Something with high curvature is just rapidly changing directions. So what can we do? Well, our idea is to say, well, let's look at what's happening in terms of the direction of our tangents. So we can move along here and look at our directions of our tangents. Now you'll see that when we have low curvature, our directions of our tangents are changing very slowly. On the other hand, when we have high curvature, our directions can change very, very fast, depending upon what time we take a look. So there's sort of this difference between saying, okay, what's happening to our tangents as we move along? Now remember, our goal is to say, I'm interested in the curve itself, not in how I move on the curve. So whether I move fast or slow, I still want the same measurement of this bending action, this twisting action. So we say, all right, so we're going to come up with a measurement. We're going to call it curvature. We denote it by kappa. It looks kind of like a K. So think of it, curvature, right? Good. So what is it? Well, it's the change in what's happening to our unit tangent vector, T, over the change in S. Now, what is S? We might say S, we've talked about before, this is our cumulative arc length. And what does that mean? Well, in other words, it's how far we've traveled. So it's really saying, think about moving along the curve, not by an amount of time, but by an amount of distance. So we're saying, we're phrasing it all in terms of distance. How does our unit tangent vector move as we move along our curve? Now, what do we know? Well, you might recall a couple of things. So this will be helpful to recall. The way we can think about S as a function of T, it's the integral from some initial time, T0, up to T of the magnitude of R prime of T dt. Remember that this is our speed. And there is one fact we're going to need in just a moment, but let's just point out right now. So suppose we take the derivative. So in other words, we're looking for ds dt. Well, what is it? Well, that's not so bad. The way we find it is we take the derivative of this side with respect to t. Now, I can already see that I've made sort of a really bad mathematical faux pas. And the bad mathematical faux pas is I'm using t's in both places. So we're just going to do a little bit of, and remind ourselves that the t's really represent different things. So the t that was on the inside, I've replaced it now by a tau. That's sort of a dummy variable, and it's just what we're integrating with respect to. The real t that matters is this t. So this is the one that, as we change our input into s, that's where our change is occurring. So when I'm talking about taking the derivative with respect to t, well, what we have is a problem that about taking derivative of an integral. And that's a very fundamental problem. So we can use the fundamental theorem of calculus and say, all right, no problem. That is the magnitude of r prime of t. Because that's what the fundamental theorem of calculus says. It says, if you're taking an antiderivative of something, and then you take the derivative again, what you end up with is you end up with the function that you were integrating. So great, fantastic. Now, one other nice fact is it turns out that if you take dt over ds, it's the reciprocal, 1 over the magnitude of r prime of t. Okay, good, good. All right, so now we've recalled what is s. Let's get back to our problem. Our problem is, how do we do a curvature? So now we have this idea. We're saying, look at how the unit tangent vector moves as we move along the curve. This is great. It's a wonderful idea. It's very intuitive. Gives us a nice measurement. There's a small detail. This is our con. It's a little bit hard to explicitly compute, right? Because we're like, oh, we've got to find the unit tangent vector. That's not always so easy, but we also have to find our function s, and we've got to write the unit tangent vector as a function of s, and it's going to not be so clear. Okay, so let's figure out how we can actually compute this. So we'll start. Say, okay, let's think about our chain rule. So I'm going to think of our unit tangent vector as being a function. So it's a function where we plug in time, but now I can think of time as a function of s. So we've talked about this before, where we said, look, we can take our cumulative arc length and we can reparameterize our curve so that we can figure out where are we at some given distance. In other words, what time did we achieve a certain distance? So now we say, look, if I want to know the derivative of t with respect to s, we just go through the layers. Take the derivative of the outside, dt with respect to the inside, dt. Of course, this sounds, you have to understand that these are different t's. So d capital T, the derivative of the unit tangent vector with respect to time. Then, keep going, next layer in, the derivative of time with respect to distance. Okay, well, these are, take the magnitudes, say, all right, great. So this is really the derivative of the unit tangent vector with respect to time, what's happening to that, and the derivative of dt ds. Wait a second. The second part we talked about just a few moments ago. So we say, aha, we're halfway there. We know that this part here, this is the same as 1 over the magnitude of r prime. Perfect, perfect. So now we're like, okay, we have to find this piece. Well, this is the magnitude of t prime. So now that's our next step, our next goal. So we say, okay, how do we do it? Well, we start saying, how can we find the magnitude of t prime, and where does it show up? Well, if we think about our acceleration, so you might recall we talked about acceleration before. In fact, it's the formula we need is down here at the bottom. I just want to point it out. We said acceleration, you can always break acceleration into two parts. One part in the direction of the unit tangent vector, and one part that's perpendicular to the direction of the unit tangent vector. So, in other words, maybe our acceleration is going this way, but they're sort of with motion, perpendicular to motion. Now, what happens? Well, the t, that's with motion, and this n is perpendicular to motion. Now, where does it show up? The way it showed up is that we took a derivative, and we said, hey, you know, we have that the normal vector, it's the derivative of the unit tangent vector, that's the right direction, but it's not a unit. So the capital N is a unit normal vector. And so you divide by the magnitude of t prime. So we say, perfect, perfect. So we can say, look, t prime, it's the magnitude of t prime times N. So we run through our acceleration computation, and we see, lo and behold, if you just run through it, this is the same thing we did. We did decomposition of acceleration, derivative of velocity. Well, velocity is, you know, magnitude times direction, and then you have your two pieces, and so you have this magnitude of r prime, magnitude of t prime, sorry, not magnitude of t prime, just t prime itself, and you say, well, wait, t prime is the magnitude of t prime times n, so you get r prime, t prime, both magnitudes, times n. But we also have another formula to compute the magnitude of r prime and magnitude t prime. Namely, this part right here has to match this part right there. So now we put it all together and we're done. Because what do we have? The magnitude of r prime t prime is the magnitude of the cross product over the magnitude of r prime. So just divide across. We say, aha, here's the magnitude of the unit tangent vector's derivative. Take the cross product of r prime and r double prime, divide by r prime squared. Now remember, that was just a part. We're almost there. We have to have this extra magnitude of r prime. So when we put that together, we get r prime cross r double prime over magnitude of r prime cubed. An alternative way to do it is to say, hey, hold on. What's really happening? Well, what's really happening is we can look at a sub n and divide by, whoops, small typo here, divide by r prime squared. There we go. Good. And why squared? Well, what happens here, this magnitude of r prime cross r double prime over magnitude of r prime, what is that? Well, that right there is a sub n. So you have to divide by magnitude of r prime, and then you have another magnitude of r prime. So that's where that shows up. All right, sorry about that typo. That's all right. Good to catch it now. Now, the nice thing is that this part right here, this works for any dimension. Works for 4, 5, 100. Whereas magnitude of the cross product has to be dimension 3. No chance. No chance otherwise. Okay. Now, wait a second. What about dimension 2? Okay, so let's talk about dimension 2. So the way we sometimes do things in two dimensions is to say, look, I can think of two dimensions as being like the xy plane sitting inside of dimension 3. So we'll add a zero entry on the end. So we have our r, you know, as x, y, 0. So similarly, r prime, x prime, y prime, 0. R double prime, x double prime, y double prime, 0. And if you run through the computations, there's nothing very fancy here. And you see, aha, if you take the cross product, you'll get x prime, y double prime, minus x double prime, y prime. And in the last entry, other entries are 0. And if you take the magnitude of r prime cubed, well, that's the magnitude of x prime, y prime, 0. And we get the following. So x prime, y double prime, minus x double prime, y prime, all over x prime squared plus y prime squared to the 3/2. Okay, so that's our way to handle curvature in dimension 2. All right, now, why curvature? It's kind of an interesting question. Why do we care about curvature? What's the historical motivation? And sort of the historical motivation goes back very, very, very far back, way before calculus started. And the idea was if you went back to ancient Greece, where you had the heart of geometry, and remember, calculus builds off of geometry, they said, we care about two things. We care about lines, and we care about circles. And those are the two things that we care about. So, fast forward a few thousand years and when people started exploring curves, and they said, well, okay, when we care about curves, what should we care about? Which is a good question. So, the first idea, so suppose we have something like this, and I want to understand the curve at a particular location, let's say I'm trying to understand the curve right there. Well, one thing we can do is we could say, look, what's happening to the tangent line? So the tangent line comes back to saying, what's the behavior as a line? So, in other words, we would have something that looks very flat. And this is kind of intuitive. We've done this before. We said, look, if we zoom in, then what we see is that our tangent line is doing something, and our curve is basically identical. It's so close, we can't distinguish. All right, great. Well, so that's the tangent line. That's thinking of it as a line. But now, where does the circle come in? And it says, don't zoom in quite so far. back it up a little bit. And what happens? Well, if you back it up a little bit, what you'll see, let me find a reasonable color here. If we zoom in not quite so far, what we'll see is we'll have our curve has a little bit of a bend to it. And so the idea was the following. They say, well, look, if the curve is a little bit has a little bit of a bend, well, that's like a piece of a circle. And so the idea was they looked and said, oh, this looks like part of a circle. And now the question becomes, what is the radius of that circle? What is that circle that it looks like? And so it turns out, and we'll see this in the practice exercises, that circles have a beautiful curvature. So in particular, answering the question of what's the curvature of a curve turns out to be equivalent to saying, well, if I think of this piece of the curve nearby, it looks like it's a piece of a circle. What's the radius of that circle? So that's what we're after with curvature. And so that's our motivation. That's why we study it. Going back to the Greeks yet again. Well, it's geometry. It's beautiful stuff. And like I said, we'll dig into this a little bit as we go through the practice problem. But for now, I think we have our idea, right? So we have a way to measure how curvy our curve is. It looks a lot like a sub n, magnitude of r prime crossed r double prime over magnitude of r prime cubed. Yes. And as long as you remember that, you'll be able to do almost everything with curvature. All right, well, let's go do some practice.